third concept that divides collectivism from individualism has to do with responsibilities and freedom of choice. We have spoken about the origin of rights, but there is a similar issue involving the origin of responsibilities. Rights and responsibilities go together. If you value the right to live your own life without others telling you what to do, then you must assume the responsibility to be independent and to provide for yourself without expecting others to take care of you. Rights and responsibilities are merely different sides of the same coin. If only individuals have rights, then it follows that only individuals have responsibilities. If groups have rights, then groups also have responsibilities, and therein lies one of the greatest ideological challenges of our modern age. Individualists are the champions of individual rights. Therefore, they accept the principle of individual responsibility rather than group responsibility. They believe that everyone has a personal and direct obligation to provide first for himself and his family and then for others who may be in need. That does not mean that they don't believe in helping each other. Just because someone is an individualist does not mean that they would have to move something like their piano by themselves. It just means that moving it is their responsibility, not someone else's, and it's up to them to organize the voluntary assistance of others. The collectivist, on the other hand, declares that individuals are not personally responsible for charity, for raising their own children, providing for aging parents, or even providing for themselves. These are group obligations of the state. The individualist expects to do it himself, and the collectivist wants the government to do it for him, to provide employment and healthcare, a minimum wage, food, education, and a decent place to live. Collectivists are enamored by government. They worship it and are fixated by government as the ultimate group mechanism to solve all problems. Individualists do not share this faith, and they see government as the creator of more problems than it solves. They believe that freedom of choice will lead to the best solution of social and economic problems by comparing millions of ideas and efforts, each one subject to trial and error and competition. The results are far superior to what can be achieved by a group of politicians or a committee of so-called wise men. By contrast, collectivists do not trust freedom. They are afraid of freedom. They are convinced that freedom may be alright in small matters such as what colour socks you want to wear, but when it comes to important issues such as the money supply, banking practices, investments, insurance programs, healthcare, education and so on, freedom will not work. These things, they say, simply must be controlled by the government. Otherwise, there would be chaos. There are two reasons for the popularity of this concept. The first is that most of us have been educated in government schools, and this is what we were taught. The second is that the government is the one group that can legally force everyone to participate. It has the power of taxation, backed by jails and force of arms, to compel everyone to fall in line, and that is a very appealing concept to the intellectual who pitches himself as a social engineer. They believe it is their obligation to mankind, as the enlightened ones, to make decisions on the behalf of society, for most are too dumb to know what their own best interests are. Individualists also believe that they are right, and that the masses seldom do what they should, but they do not accept that you can force people to comply with your will. To do this would be to establish a principle that would open the door for others, representing larger groups, to compel them to act as they decree, and that would be the end of freedom. One of the quickest ways to spot a collectivist is to see how he reacts to public problems. No matter what bothers him in his daily routine, whether it's littering the highway, smoking in public, dressing indecently, bigotry, or even sending out junk mail, his immediate response is, "There ought to be a law." Of course, the professionals in government who make a living from coercion are more than happy to cooperate. The consequence is that government just keeps growing and growing. It is a one-way street. Every year there are more and more laws and less freedom. Each law by itself seems relatively benign, justified by some convenience or for the greater good of the greater number, but the process continues forever until government is total and freedom is dead. Bit by bit, the people themselves become the solicitor of their own enslavement. A good example of this collectivist mindset is the use of government to perform acts of charity. Most people believe that we have a responsibility to help others in need. But what about those who disagree? Those who couldn't care less about the needs of others? Should they be allowed to be selfish while the rest of us are so generous? The collectivist sees people like this as justification for the use of coercion, because the cause is so worthy. Of course, not all of it gets to the poor. It takes a giant bureaucracy to administer a public charity, and the individuals in government have become accustomed to a large portion of that wealth, while the rest are grateful for whatever they can get. They don't care how much is consumed in the process because, after all, it was stolen from someone else anyway. We all know the biblical story of the Good Samaritan who stopped to help a stranger who had been robbed and beaten, but what would we think if the Samaritan had pointed his sword at the next traveller and threatened to kill him if he didn't also help? At that point, the Samaritan would have been no different to the original robber, whose motive for attacking the victim could well have been to feed his family or to afford a better doctor for his wife. Regardless, a crime done for virtuous motives is a crime nonetheless. When coercion enters, charity leaves. Individualists believe that a person should be free not to be charitable. If they prefer to give to a different charity, if they prefer to give a smaller amount, or if they prefer not to give at all, there is no right to force him to our will. We may try to persuade him, we may appeal to his conscience, and especially, we may show the way by our own good example. But individualists reject any attempt to gang up on him, either by physically restraining him while removing money from his pockets, or by using the ballot box to pass laws that will take his money through taxation. In either case, the principle is the same. It's called stealing. Collectivists would have you believe that individualism is merely another word for selfishness, because individualists oppose welfare and other forms of coercive redistribution of wealth. But just the opposite is true. Individualists advocate true charity, which is the voluntary giving of their own money, while collectivists advocate the coercive giving of other people's money, which is, of course, why it is so popular. One of the most popular slogans of Marxism is, "From each according to his ability, to each according to his need." That is the cornerstone of theoretical socialism, and it is a very appealing concept, but it is incomplete. The unanswered question is, how is this to be accomplished? Shall it be in freedom or through coercion? For the individualist, a worthy objective does not justify committing theft and surrendering freedom, while for the collectivist, the ends justify the means. In the next part of this series, we examine equality and inequality under law. We will study how collectivists use government for welfare and to enforce racial or gender quotas in order to bring about a more equal society, and also the opposite view of individualism, that regardless of personal inequalities of means or circumstance, we all deserve the same equality under the law.